Hi, and welcome to Find, Tell, Share. My name is Jemma Rosenthal, and I help people to find their voices. And this is
Chris Sissons. My business is Market Together. I'm a local marketing coach specializing in using stories to market and develop your business. And today I'm delighted to introduce our guest, Lee Furness, who has found that during the lockdown of 2020, he had time to learn some new skills and developed a cottage industry at the bottom of his garden. Hello, Lee.
Hello, Chris. And hello, Gemma.
Hi, Lee.
Nice to meet you both.
And nice to talk to you today, Lee. So we're going to start with the find part of Find, Tell, Share. So this is a storyteller's podcast, and we're about all things storytelling. So the first thing, when we need to find a story, for any listeners out there that are interested in how do we find stories, how do we get our inspiration? Well, we are going to talk about how we find that inspiration. So Lee, what kind of things have you been doing to find your inspiration?
Hi, Gemma. Yes, well, recently I've been going on, I guess you could call them long distance walks. And the idea was to really blow the cobwebs out and try and get fitter, because I have a problem of overeating. I just don't know when to stop. And So a few weeks ago, I went on one. It was about 20 miles, and it was up Wynn Hill, Moose Hill, Mam Tor, around Edale and all the way back. And I loved it. So following week, I did it again, the other way around. And, you know, I'm going to go again on Tuesday. And whilst I'm on the track, you know, the first 20 minutes always feel a bit tough. You know, oh, God, yeah. What am I doing? Especially when I'm on my own, you know. And then you'll find no matter what time, I went for sunrise and somebody ran past me. There were already people up there running. It makes you realize I'm not the only idiot up there. And but whilst you're going along, your mind just goes all over. And because you're going to be walking for 10 hours, I can allow myself to go wherever it is. So I start off probably thinking about work and different things, but before long, I'm on another plane and I come back feeling absolutely brilliant.
Excellent. Yeah. I think walking can be a really good way of clearing the mind, and then you can have inspired things. I know sometimes, because I write songs, and sometimes when I'm on a walk, the song will just come in straight away, and I'll have to either get my phone out and just sing into it. Sometimes I'll just be on a random walk and just singing into my phone, and people wonder what I'm doing, but I just have to get it down. Or do you take anything with you, like to record any ideas, like a notepad or anything like that?
What I took last time is all my camera gear. I thought, see if I can get some really lovely pictures, because it was a really hot day, and realized it was too big. I only need to take a small bag. I do voice to camera a little bit, but no, I don't really. I should. Mm. I should. Good idea.
Yeah. Well, it's a topic that I often speak about and write about. And one of my epigrams is solvitur ambulando, which means solve it by walking. It's very often, if you've got a problem, go for a walk, you can solve it. Or sometimes you solve a different problem altogether, but you do solve a problem. And it's fascinating. It's reminded me, I saw a video. I doubt whether I'll be able to find it again, but if I do, I'll put it in the information beneath. And it was a baby elephant that was stuck in a ditch, upside down in a ditch. And its mother was trying to get it out and failed. And the other elephants were attacking the mother for some reason. And then another herd of elephants came along, and a female elephant from that herd went and had a go, which in itself was interesting. Yeah, it was a completely different animal, and still couldn't get the baby elephant out. And then, this is the thing, she walked away and then stopped, turned around and came back again, and she did it. yeah, just taking those few steps away and coming back again, and reunited the baby elephant with its mother, which is a wonderful ending.
Yeah, it's really good. So, Chris,
me,
what have you been finding this week?
One of the things I've been thinking about, and I shall write about this at some point, is masks. I don't want to get into a conversation about the mask that we have to wear when we go into shops, but that's where it started. And we were having a conversation about it a couple of weeks ago with a group of people online. And I found myself saying it would be interesting to see if anybody's ever written a history of masks, because masks have had a role in human civilization from way, way back. And I don't know that anybody's written a history. I have had a look on Amazon. There are one or two books that look promising, but I didn't really see a definitive history of masks there. But one of the things that came to my mind is something I've been aware of for some years. In Greek theatre, the actors wore masks, and there were big, heavy masks. And if you know about your Greek amphitheatre, this amplifies the sound. The masks also amplified the sound. So if you were sat in the audience, you understood which character was speaking and on the stage through sound. And the Latin for through sound is per sonar. So that's P-E-R, per, and then sonar as in submarines when they go bing and detect another submarine underneath them. And that is where we get the English word person from. So through sound, through the mass, we get the English word person.
Oh.
And then another dimension to my story, and I don't want to go on too long, so I'll truncate as much as I can, was when I went on a weekend retreat about personality types. And there were about 50 of us there, sat in 9 groups around the room, each group being a different personality type. And we were given a task to do, and then the idea was we'd do the task and then see how the different types cope with it. And my group was the most terrifying group of people I've ever sat in. Everyone had their arms folded. Everyone was sat sort of scowling, looking very intense. Nobody said a word while all the other groups were getting on with it. The men all had beards and glasses. The women all had their hair tight back and were very tweedy. And I looked around this group, and I've never seen such a frightening group of people in my life. And in the end, I thought, well, I'm a community development worker, so if I can't get this moving, nobody can. So I said something, and immediately the ice broke, and it was fine from there on, and we did brilliant work for the rest of the weekend. But that showed me that I wear a mask. I'm not quite sure what the right verb is. Wear is obviously not the right word, but it also means that we all wear masks, not necessarily the frightening keep off mask, but and so that's what I want to write about. Jemma, you've got a thought.
So this just to make it clear to the audience, this was it a personality? You've talked about it before. Explain just a little bit more about what this group was.
Yeah,
just so it's clear.
Well, there are various personality typing systems. The most famous one is Myers-Briggs, but the one I use is called the Enneagram, which is Greek this time. You learn your classical languages on this show. The Ninegram, so it's a picture and shows the relationships between the 9 types.
So, Lee, any thoughts on masks and finding inspiration from masks and persona? Have you heard this before about that?
Well, persona is a word in itself. And when he explained that, I thought, oh, if that's the two together. My wonderful time when I really rejoiced in wearing a mask is when I took my wife to the carnival in Venice, and we hired these costumes, and I had my hat was a tricorn hat with feathers, a cloak and ruffled shirts and trousers that only came to the knees and stockings. And my wife had this huge bustle, so wide we couldn't walk down the, she couldn't walk straight, had to go sideways down some of the alleyways. And everywhere we went, people just wanted our photograph and what have you. And that was 3 days of feeling like a superstar.
Yeah.
It was just, and allowing yourself just to enjoy it and going for banquets and dancing. And it was just lovely.
That sounds really lovely.
So have you not worn masks on the stage, Jemma?
I have, yes. I made a mask as well. When I was at college, we did Comedy dell’Arte, I think it's called. So we actually made these masks, and one of mine had a very long nose, I just remember. So I'll move on to my find as well. Thank you, for Chris and Lee, for the walking and the masks. So just, to remind our audience, we're talking about inspiration, how we find it. And I've been actually looking back on stories of my lifetime. So I actually did a timeline yesterday where I wrote down 1990, which is when I was born, and then to 2020. And I went through each year and sort of wrote down key events or key times when I'd done certain things in my life. And I've been looking back at stories. I had a chat with Chris the other day about, because I talk about finding your voice. So I was looking back on stories where perhaps I didn't find my voice, because there was one time, my first time singing in front of the school. Well, it was my second time, but the first time I played a character that couldn't sing. But I actually could sing. And then the second time when I actually got a chance to sing, I froze and I started laughing and then I started crying because I was only young. I was looking out into the audience and there was this girl that was a really good singer and I felt really insecure. So I've just been sort of, but then later on I overcome that and ended up singing I Will Survive on another school show. So I kind of combined those two stories, but it was interesting because Chris talks about how you can actually use separate events in your life, but then combine them to create a story. So I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, Lee.
Yeah, I do. Because sometimes when I've had to give a presentation and I've started off trying to talk on whatever topic it is, and then I start off realizing that I've got a lot of preamble before I get to the story, and there's loads I want to add. But it's still true if I combine other things, that like in other parts of my life that happened, but cut out the preamble. So it might not be true in terms of what happened where and when, but actually the essence. To make it into an engaging story or something that people will follow, I've been able to do that sort of thing.
So yes, Chris, do you want to go on to your talking of engaging stories? Let's hand over to Chris so that Lee can tell his engaging story that we've brought him on today to share.
Okay, Lee, just have a bit of a chat before you start the story, just to give people a bit of context. And there'll be people here listening who know you already and people who don't and so on. I think the first time I met you was when you were working out of Abbeyfield House in Pittsmore, Sheffield. And you were with Green City Action.
Yeah, was an organisation whose term of reference was to make Burngreave, Pittsmore, a greener and nicer place to live. It's quite a broad term. It's an environmental organisation.
Yes, well, I'm not sure whether we're any greener than we were back then. The council's cut the trees down. I think you escaped from Pittsmore, didn't you?
I was in Pittsmore for nearly 30 years or something silly, a long time. We're now in Netheredge and we've been here 5 years.
Right.
And I've got the most lovely garden. So
we're going to hear about that.
We've had lockdown. But just saying, it's just so nice to have a garden. Whereas when I was in Pittsmore, I had a handkerchief of a garden, and I never had a lawn. You know, we've got a lawnmower, and I'm must be the only person in the planet who enjoys mowing the lawn because I've never had one before.
Yeah. And then after a period when we didn't meet, I think we bumped into one another at a business fair at the Pondsforge swimming baths. And you put me in touch with the Public Speaking Academy, and you were there for a few years.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. I've been a coach with the Public Speaking Academy for, I don't know, 7 years, something like that, and really enjoyed it. And yeah, it was great to link up. And knowing your background, I didn't actually think you would gain a lot from it because you're quite a confident presenter yourself. But seeing you over the years, it's been really lovely.
Yeah, oh, it has, yes. And I hope we'll see you there again now and again. So now you're doing something mysterious at the bottom of your garden.
Sitting on the couch with my wife, on the edge of the couch, was a bit odd because our couch is a big, red, luxurious sofa that invites you to sit back. But we weren't sitting back in the chairs. We were perched on the edge, sort of staring at the widescreen in front of us, staring in anticipation. Already it was an hour late. It should have started at 3 o'clock and now it's 4:15. But then he appeared. And as he walked towards the rostrum, looking like he'd just got out of the shower and couldn't find a hairdryer or hairbrush, Boris said those words, "From tomorrow, we're going to lock down. From tomorrow, you will not be allowed to go to work unless it's vital. You will not be able to visit your family or friends. You must stay at home." We looked at each other. We knew it was coming. We knew lockdown was coming. In fact, I thought it should have been a few weeks earlier, but now it's here. What are we going to do? Following day, I went into the front garden and looked down the street. I've never seen so many cars before. Not driving, they were all parked. The road was full of parked cars. Not a moving car, not a pedestrian, not a cyclist. That stillness was somehow really beautiful. But at the same time, it was a little bit eerie, a little bit creepy. But it was then I started to get the text messages. At first, it was a trickle, turned into a torrent of text messages, all using different words but saying the same thing. "Hi, Lee, I'm really sorry to say, but we don't think it's appropriate to have a cleaner in our house at the moment. You see, I've got this cleaning company I set up 18 years ago that has been running in the background for years and years. And so now the clients are all cancelling. We should have been cleaning 158 houses this week, and now we're not cleaning any." I sent a reply to them all, trying to mitigate it. Instead of cancelling, my reply was, "Thank you for your message, and yes, these are uncertain times," I said. "And I propose that we postpone the cleaning until we get a new normal, until things get back to normal." sort of worked, but how long is this going to go on for? The following day, the Chancellor stood at that same rostrum and he said, we're going to support businesses, we're going to support the employed, and we're going to support the self-employed. I wasn't expecting that. I wasn't. Turns out that none of that support has got my name on it. It never seems to. No, for whatever reason, I'm not entitled to any of it. But hey, the sun was shining. We were going for a walk every day and finding things we didn't know about our local area. And I managed to do all those little DIY jobs that I'd never got round to doing. I'd even found DIY jobs that I'd forgotten that I'd put them off. So many jobs. And that was good. It meant that things got done around the house that hadn't been done. But as the days turned into weeks and as the week turned into the month, I was starting to get concerned about having no income. Really, having no income. And those terms that you've always heard since childhood, you know, I've heard of people saying, I go to work to put food on the table. And actually, for the first time in my life, I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to go to Tesco or Aldi to get food put on the table. But as that month came to an end, and there was another 2 months ahead that we knew of, I thought, how else can I make this time a fruitful time? What can I do? Should I learn a language? You know, if so, what language should I try and do? And it's whilst I was surfing YouTube, which I seem to be doing quite a lot of recently, I came across some wood carving tutorials by a guy called Geordie, who lives in Canada. And he was making bird boxes, and with the bird box, he would carve a face on the front. It was called a wood spirit. A wood spirit, I don't know if you know, it's a legend that goes back in Europe about 500 or 600 years, but it's also connected to the green man, which goes back 4,000 years. But if you think of an old man's face, a bit like Gandalf, an old man with a big, long, flowing beard, this is the sort of face he was carving. And the entrance to the birdhouse was through the mouth of the wood spirit. And I loved it. The way he described it, he was very real, no pretense whatsoever. He would swear if he banged his finger and what have you. But the way he described how to do things, I thought, I might be able to do this. Now, I have done some wood carving 20 years ago, and I've got a set of old Sheffield-made rusty chisels in the shed. But I would never do a face. I had tried because you can spend a lot of time, and even if you get a beautiful nose, get the lips looking great, but if one eye is slightly off, then the whole thing is ruined. Because you look at a statue, and if one eye is slightly off, that's all you can see. So I wouldn't normally do faces. But I thought I was going to give it a go. My first few attempts were appalling. Really, really bad. I would say rubbish, but actually, on reflection, they weren't rubbish and they weren't appalling. They were what you would expect if you were a beginner. So my perception of my abilities, once again, maybe didn't match up to the reality of life. And so I committed to myself to do one wood carving every day and to see if I could pick up these skills. And within 2 weeks, I'd come up with something I was really pleased with. It was pretty much like he'd showed us. I'd made the birdhouse and I'd carved a face on the front, deep-set eyes, chiseled cheek, and a big, long beard, and a hole for the... Mine's specifically for blue tits, with a hole in their mouth. And I loved it. I was really proud of it. And I posted it on Facebook, as you do nowadays. And straight away, I started to get wonderful comments, like, that's amazing. Awesome job, Lee. That's wonderful. Didn't know you had it in you. And that is really quite inspiring to hear those things, especially at a time when outwardly I'm confident to everyone else. But inside, I'm thinking, what the hell am I going to do? You know, this is a difficult time. And but then it followed by people saying, oh, can I have one? Or will you do one for me? Put me down for one. And orders were coming through right at the beginning. I wasn't sure if they were asking me to make them for free, their friends, give it as a gift. I thought, how can I broach this? And how much should I charge? How much do you charge? You can't. There is nothing like it out there. And I thought, well, on Amazon you can get a really cheap birdhouse, and in gardens, you know, for about £15. In a garden centre, you can pay £25 to £35 for a nice birdhouse. But mine is a birdhouse with a carving. It's not really a work of art. It's not really just a birdhouse. So I plumped at £50. See what happens. I got 10 orders in that first week. 10 orders at £50. And I thought, this is great. If I could do 10 every week, then that would be amazing. That's £500. Yes. And so all sorts of stuff is coming out of my head here thinking, oh, yes, new beginnings. Trouble was, it didn't take me a week. It took me more than 2 weeks. It took me about 2.5 weeks to do them. But of course, I was slower. I was still getting better. But with each one that I did, I was getting better. And I tried to focus on each one in a certain area. See if I can make the eye better. See if I can do the eyebrows different. Let's make this nose a bit more exaggerated. Let's make it a big pointy nose. Or let's put a hook in this nose. Or let's have really big, wide nostrils. And as I got towards the end of those first 10, I was able to amalgamate all of these works in the future ones that I started to do. And so that first order of 10 turned into 20, which turned into 30. So my garden shed's getting a lot of work here. And it is quite hard work to do it. But I have to say that this week I've got an order from the USA and one from Australia on top of the ones I've got in the UK. So that's amazing. Now, we've got some quarantine issues there. If you've ever watched Border Force or whatever it is on whatever channel that is, you know you can't take wood or organic products into Australia and America. But I'm looking for certified wood that comes with a certificate of where it was grown and what treatment it's had to be able to fulfill those. Because to be able just to, that somebody in Australia wants me to send it, and they'll pay for the postage, is quite a big thing. So there we are, and that's my cottage industry that has born out of spending a bit of time doing not much during lockdown, but wondering what to do. And it just sort of, I don't suppose it fell into my lap, but when you're looking for something, and I have experience many years ago of when I was unemployed about being really desperate to get a job. And if you're that too desperate, it actually makes it harder to get the job. So, and I deliberately just tried to relax, not to panic, and it sort of just seemed to come nicely. So that's my story of my lockdown cottage industry. Oh, and so I also set up a web page, Wood Spirit Birdhouse, that's what, a Wood Spirit Birdhouse, and a Facebook page as well, which has helped.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
That sounds amazing.
Oh, thank you.
I love how you just used your inspiration. So, you know, when you get into these moments where you don't know what to do, where to find a job, and then it's like you literally carved out a new path.
If it gets in the newspaper, that's going to be their headline, isn't it?
Yeah.
He carved out a new future for himself.
Yes.
Yes, yes. That's Yeah, and I mean, I was delighted to see your email address, which has got the the Wood Spirit Bird House actually in the address, is almost memorable. Most email addresses aren't. So, how does this work as a story? I mean, I noticed there was a lot at the start that would help anybody listening to relate to the story, because I should imagine a lot of people have remember the day of the announcement of the lockdown and were sat waiting to hear what the Prime Minister had to say and so on, and then the experience of walking through the quiet streets and the changes that had happened. So there was a lot, and that relationship draws people into the story. And of course, what was different for you was the sudden loss of your business. And most people would be delighted when the phone rings because it's contact with another human being. But when you know that it's going to be another cancelled appointment, it's a different sort of thing. But maybe, there could be quite a few people out there who also had that sort of experience. so that sort of draws us in. And then the inspiration coming from a YouTube video, and then the work that you had to do, to get to the point where you can produce these in reasonable numbers, and then the opening up to the rest of the world, and then having to address the issues that come with exporting bird boxes. There's a lot there. Ooh. Yes. So.
Yeah.
But was it engaging?
Yeah, I think so.
It was very engaging.
Yeah, and I think one of the key things that it's the detail, and relatable stuff. Because people think stories have got to be about unicorns and dragons and all sorts of exciting things. But people actually do get very excited about what might seem quite trivial details. Because sometimes it evokes memories. And there were people, as I say, who can relate to that day when the lockdown was announced. And lots of lots of small details, like the chisels weren't just chisels, they were rusty chisels. I mean, presumably they're not rusty anymore.
Gemma.
Yes.
Yeah, I was just going to say that one of the things that I focus on within my coaching is how we tell, how we use our voice, whether it's that's to tell a story or sing a song. And what I really loved is how engaging your vocals were when you were telling the story. The way you use your voice, and you use a lot of pauses in a way that really got us to listen to what you were saying. So it was like your voice was kind of, you were talking about maybe things where you might have had, what's going on, what's this, but then the way you told it made it feel so calming. Mm-hmm. And I think it was a really nice way to do it, because it just shows the kind of way that you can find these new pathways through that inspiration, and to not allow this situation to then determine whether your destiny, I suppose, or how you go moving forward. Yeah.
Thank you. It's lovely to hear, because when you're doing it yourself, it's just yourself. And then I took a couple of hours out this morning just to run over it a few times. But I don't know, you know, hearing what you've said is it's lovely to hear, because I did practice a couple of times. One of the things I know from past experience is not to practice too much, because then if I've done it 100 times, I can get lost in where, did I say that already? Oh, no, because it's...
Yes.
So I needed to run through it a couple of times. Mm.
I told my story yesterday online, and I was careful. I practiced a few times, but then I was careful not to overdo it, because then, you do kind of end up just thinking too much about the details. And sometimes it's more about the flow of the story, which is something that I like to focus on as well. It's how you tell it, not just about the story itself or what the details of the story. It's kind of how can you engage the audience, how can you bring them in to that world. And I think you did it so well. And obviously your experience of, I don't know if you can talk a little bit about your experience with the Public Speaking Academy, and just any tips you have for our audience around how can they start to tell their stories.
Yes, there's a number of things, and one of the things that really helped here, of course, this is audio, and our listeners will only be hearing this, but at the moment we can see each other. And so seeing yourself, you both of you nodding, and you occasionally giggling, and I could see that you were liking it, and I could hear just little chuckles. That gave me the sense that I was on the right course. Whereas if it had been totally like facing a mirror and it's just myself, then it's just guesswork whether, you know, it is. It's good. So, but also that gave me the opportunity to relax and get into it, because, So how would I do it? If I was doing a presentation and I've got an audience, then I'm looking at everyone and I'm engaging them both with my eyes, my body language, and I'm seeing how they're reacting. And many times I'll change what I'm saying because of the audience behavior, you know, to make them more engaged or whatever. And that could be by lowering my voice or making it louder, speaking slower, as you say, putting deliberate pauses in. And of course, if you find someone who looks really bored and aren't really paying attention, then I deliver most of the presentation to them. So every time they look up, I'm looking at them. So they put down their phone and they can't not look at their phone because I'm delivering it to them. And then they've got to start smiling at me because I'm smiling. And whether they like it or not, you have to be a hard character to resist my persistent a story being directed to you.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
And you would know that, because you wouldn't fall asleep, would you?
I never fall asleep. No. he lied. That's why I take notes. I've got evidence. I've got 3 pages of notes. So I didn't fall asleep. Yes. But I was going to say, I think it's really important. You know, the audience makes a massive difference. And that's one reason that the way we record now, we can see each other even though we don't record the images. I've heard it several times. For example, footballers saying that they perform better at kicking footballs around when they've got a crowd egging them on. Musicians find it easier when they have an audience. So and this is one of the odd things about public speaking in general. People fear public speaking. It's one of the greatest fears that people have. And yet when you experience the audience that you used to fear is now a source of inspiration. Yeah, it completely turns over. And it's just so much easier with an audience. Yes.
Okay, so we're moving on to the share part. So this part of the podcast is where we talk about media and it might be something that we want to share, or it could be something that we have experienced maybe on a certain type of media that we'd like to share today. So, Chris, do you want to share something about what you have to share today?
Me, right, it's me. Yes, what I,
yep.
I work with stories a great deal, and usually I talk about using stories in marketing, using stories for business development. But there's a third strand to that, as I want to mention today, that I think is really important, but perhaps less appreciated. And that's the role of stories in helping us to identify our real work as opposed to our paid work. Now, some lucky people, maybe Lee with his birdhouses, their real work and their paid work is pretty much the same. But that's not true for everybody. And I do believe that the real work, that's the work that only you can do, work that's worth doing even when it fails, but the work that actually fires you up and makes you feel fulfilled is absolutely essential. And the sad thing is that very often the paid work, which is also essential, is pushes out, because more essential, and it tends to push out the real work. And so many of us, although we might be running a business, don't feel fulfilled. And also many people who are, for example, coaches in business, they really enjoy the coaching and they don't enjoy all the business stuff that goes around it, like managing finance and marketing and all that stuff. So there's something about that balance, and stories can really help us with that. Now, my inspiration for that, this is getting onto the media bit, is Megan Macedo. And Megan is a great storyteller. She started out, I won't go through a whole life story, but when she started in self-employment, she started out as a marketing coach and a website designer. But she's moved on from that. She doesn't really do that anymore. She uses storytelling to help business people become themselves in their business. And she says that we all have a unique take on the world and get more satisfaction when we base our business on things we really care about and that give us satisfaction. So she's pioneered a new approach to business that confounds the standard marketing approaches. So almost everything that you're told to do for marketing, Megan's advice is to do the opposite. because working on your real work is about following up things that are possibly not going to end up with any sort of financial reward. But unless you do those, you're never going to find the thing that will. Because when you achieve something, that unlocks new doors, and you go through those doors and they unlock new doors, and eventually you get to somewhere where no one's been before, and that could be what you need. If you go to her website, and the link will be with this podcast somewhere if you look around it, and scroll down a bit, you'll find a video on the homepage, and that video is really worth watching. First of all, it's an excellent video, but it tells her personal story and relates it to her business. And it's a brilliant example of how to do that really well. So that's my recommendation for today.
Thanks, Chris. Lee, what are your thoughts on kind of that in terms of like, how did you find your real work and your paid work, and how do you manage that?
Yeah, it's often a dream of people to get paid for doing what you love. But actually you've got to be careful what you wish for, because for many people, then they get fed up of doing something that they loved doing. You know, gotta be careful. So there is a fine balance. And, you know, I'm getting on a bit now. I don't think of myself as being old, but I am 60. And I've had plenty of years where I've gone to work for others just to make a wage, to be then enable me to do other things. And there is still something in that, to be able to go and do a job, get paid, so that when you come home, instead of just sitting down and watching Coronation Street, you're actually doing something, whatever your own desires are, in your case, playing music or learning or whatever it is, that gives you free space where you're not thinking about work. I mean, I would never have taken a call from work at 10 o'clock at night when I was working for somebody else. But now, when you work for yourself, you know, it's all intermixed and what have you. Sure, I can separate my time during the day to do things that I love to do, like I was doing some carving earlier, and I was doing some cleaning business earlier, and I can mix and match. But it's not, you know, working for someone else and doing, don't want to say dead-end job, but doing a job for the sake of it, sometimes it's not so bad, because, you know, lots of benefits come with that.
Yeah. I sometimes, so I do a lot of paid, a lot of my work is my real work and my paid work, but then sometimes it's not, and sometimes I haven't been paying for things, and sometimes I have, so it's a bit of a mixture. And I think I know what you mean, because sometimes when I, like, when I worked in a toy shop when I was younger, and I always find ways of using the job to enhance other skills, like people skills, or even just organization. So they taught me how to organize the toys and put them in the order that they needed to be seen. And it's kind of like, you can use it to improve other skills, but also as a sort of a meditation as well, because if you're doing something that's kind of, I don't want to say the word monotonous, but as in, you know, it's kind of repetitive, you can use it as a sort of way to almost find inspiration, because then sometimes something might, an idea might come in from doing the job. So then you could maybe write a story about that job, or if I was playing a character, because I do acting as well, it might be that I then know about that job to then be able to play that character. Yeah.
And I don't know if you have, I'm sure you know of Peter Kay, the comedian.
Yeah.
And he will often talk about his time working as a doing a mundane job. And even when he was doing quite well, he was on TV and doing big concerts, he still had a ticket collector's job at one of his local cinemas. And he would go from one to another. He said, well, you know, in the early days, he didn't know if that new business was going to collapse. But also it kept him grounded. You know, he's got most of his stories from his time at school, from his early jobs. His stories aren't from when he's a big famous comedian. They're all from doing pretty mundane jobs, but observing. And I've helped people through the years when they've had a fairly mundane job and weren't sure how to go through it. And I've talked to them about, well, try and learn the business. Even if you're working for McDonald's, get all your stripes and stars and learn how to do it. So maybe you might have your own hamburger business. You might have another business entirely. But the business of business is not too different. What you actually do is the different bit. But how to, as you say, interact with customers, how to customer service, how to take the money, how do you count it up, all those things. How to sweep the floor, making sure it's nice and clean, because nobody wants to go into a dirty restaurant. All those things come into whatever you might do in the future or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So do you have something to talk about in terms of share as well, Lee?
I do. I've got a new find. I say a new find. It's about 6 months ago. I came across TikTok, which everyone's talking about. And when I first mentioned it, people say, oh, that's for kids. And sure, there's a lot of young kids on it. But you can click on the things that you're interested in. So mostly what I see. And for those that don't know, TikTok is it like YouTube or whatever. It will show you video after video of things that you're interested in. And I have creativity clicked and art, photography, videography, and dance. And those are mostly what I see. And they come through. And there's some really talented people around the world. And it's lovely because it might be somebody who's in India or China or Saudi Arabia or wherever, really talented. And their view on what they're doing is just a delight. And I've learned tons from it. And I've got 45 views now. No, I had a few hundred views. There's a big thing at the moment because America says that TikTok's spying on you for China's government and stuff like that. And I think that comes from every Chinese-owned company has got to give its information up if requested. But it's actually, because headquarters is in America. However, so I deleted it. I thought, oh, I don't want that. And then I thought, oh, actually, I do. So I put it back on. And then I'd lost all of my past history. It had gone, so I had to start again.
Oh.
And all my six viewers are going to have to go without. They have to find me again.
Yeah.
So TikTok, for a laugh, and it's mostly positive stuff. There is some nasty stuff, I'm sure. I've never seen it or been witness to it, but it's just positive stuff, and take it or leave it.
I really like the way you have such a positive viewpoint on things, and I think the attitude that you have towards, like, even just TikTok, it's just refreshing. And I think it probably serves you quite well to have that positive way of viewing things.
Oh, thank you, Jemma.
I don't know TikTok at all.
Chris, have you got any thoughts on TikTok or what we talked about before, if you wanted to say something before?
Chris, I'll describe it to you.
Like
a grandfather clock.
Hickory dickory dock. Actually, wasn't there a character in Wizard of Oz, or one of the later books, called TikTok? There's a mechanical man. I think that might be where it came from. Maybe someone can do some research and let us know. I mean that's one of the great opportunities for the internet in general. It enables us to find a whole lot of stuff that we wouldn't have found otherwise. And a lot of it is valuable. It's quite difficult to get any work done. You know, if you're not careful, you get sidetracked. And that's right.
That's what I have to be careful that I'm not, because I don't have TikTok, but I have Instagram. Mm. And if I go on too long, I won't do I may be sharing work, but I also need to spend time outside or on my piano or something. Which leads me on to the final sharing, which is me. And you can obviously give some feedback after as well. But I'm just going to share a song that I wrote. I think it was around maybe 2011. I think I first wrote it. And it actually ended up later on when I came back to Sheffield, because I was in London at the time when I wrote it, and it ended up being in a musical. And the original musical, written by Ross Bannister, who was working with me at the time, he was the acting teacher and I was the musical theatre director of the Fusion Youth Theatre. So it was a youth theatre, and the song came into the part where the girl had joined a new theatre company and she was a bit shy to share her singing because she felt kind of new. So I decided to offer this song that I'd already written as part of the story. And it's really about finding music, finding songs. And I was inspired by a musical theatre writer called Stephen Sondheim, who did Into the Woods and Sweeney Todd, and he has a book called Finishing the Hat. And I was looking at some of the techniques for songwriting, and I kind of then it inspired a song. So I'm going to play it on my keyboard, and I'm not sure how the sound's going to come out, so just bear with me on this if you're listening, and I hope that you can hear it.
It sounds lovely.
Yeah? Okay. I have a feeling, I'm not sure quite why, there must be a solution, something else to try. I cried for a while, and something stirred in my mind, and it made me smile, to know there's something else to find. There's a song when I feel like there's nowhere to run, and my tears have all dried up and gone, and it helps me breathe. There's a song when my feelings are out there to see, don't need to be anyone else but me, and I feel the music reaching a part of me, connecting somewhere inside my core. I no longer feel I should hide anymore. There's a song when I feel like there's nowhere to run, and my tears have all dried up and gone, and it helps me breathe. There's a song when my feelings are out there to see, don't need to be anyone else but me, and I feel free.
Lovely.
Thank you. So that was a shortened version. So I cut out a couple of verses, but you can hear the whole version actually sung by a young girl called Issa, who I was teaching the song to. And it's on SoundCloud, so we'll put a link on. But I've tagged in it. It's not on my SoundCloud. I've tagged my, I think it should be on my SoundCloud now, so Jemma Rosenthal, but I will also tag the link on this. Any thoughts on, obviously it was a shortened version, and I don't know if you could hear the lyrics or not, but it's basically about how you find a song, and about inspiration around songs.
Yeah, it was lovely. I found myself listening to little, not phrases, parts of the sentence, and thinking mm-hmm. over that, and then you'd have another little part, and I can hardly even remember them, but you know, it was something like, you were crying, and then shortly afterwards you were laughing, because
yeah.
of something, and then running away, and I can't remember the words at the time.
No, it's okay.
And so, but it really sounded like I could see it in a musical. I could imagine that being somebody on stage singing it and what have you. Lovely.
Yeah. We actually added some vocals at the end. The stage version had all the children came in and sang at the end, and they were like, like in the background. Yeah, so it was just so beautiful, just having, hearing the voices of the children.
First of all, I think it illustrates what I was saying earlier about real work. And,
I know you've heard
projects.
This song before.
And, you know, you wrote the song, and then when you were working on the musical, you were able to go back and get that song and put it into the musical. so writing that song actually opened a door when you got to the musical, and that's worth knowing. The other thing is I'm not quite sure why, but it reminded me of a song I've known for many years. In the 1970s, when I was at university, we were all fans of a singer called Pete Atkin. I don't know whether you remember him, Lee. Pete Atkin. And the thing was, his lyricist was Clive James, who you may have heard of. He's an Australian writer. He died fairly recently. And one of his songs, I'm just remembering some of the lyrics, 50 years in the racket, a brindled crew cut and a silk-lined jacket. But it isn't me the punter's come to hear. It's a little girl just starting to begin. I'd kill that kid if she weren't killing me. And he's playing the piano in an empty nightclub. And the last line, I think, if my memory serves, an hour alone is freedom for the slave.
Wow.
And it's an incredibly moving song. And but it's just that. and I suppose it relates to what I was saying about real work, because there you've got someone who, is clearly musical and has some talent, but he's not valued. He's not found a place for himself.
And it's good to see that your brain really is intact, that you can remember these lyrics from the songs that were written 40 years ago.
Well, I've heard it. Yeah, I've heard it since 40 years ago.
and so, Gemma, where have you played? Obviously, you've been in musicals, but have you performed yourself? What's your stage name?
My stage name is Jemma Rosenthal. I do have some ideas for possible future stage names, but I'll just keep that under. I think at the moment it's just my name, because that's what people know me as. And I've last year I actually did quite a few gigs at different events, just singing my own songs, and I've worked with other artists and things.
Lovely.
But but at the moment I'm kind of focusing more on the coaching side of things, although I will be doing and hopefully some recordings soon as well. But I think one of the things that Chris said about, the real doing my songwriting just naturally then led to more opportunities to get paid to put that in a musical. And it's not something that I could have kind of planned in a sense. But I think what I would encourage the listeners to do, and a bit like Lee's story, I think it ties in well of how he didn't give up on what he was passionate about. He found something even you could maybe even not necessarily use the word passion, but it's about using that curiosity, because there's a really good creativity teacher, a writer actually called Elizabeth Gilbert. So she wrote Eat, Pray, Love, but she also wrote a book called Big Magic, and she talks about creativity and how you should follow your curiosity. And I think that's exactly what you did in your story. Mm. And it's kind of what I did as well, because I was just reading this book and then I was curious, oh, could I write a song in this way? And just use a few rhymes here and put it together like a musical. And I think encouraging our listeners to really follow those little inklings, you know, go for your walk, get your mind clear, and then start crafting. Yeah. Any more, anything else to add, Lee?
And so thank you for the opportunity to join you. Look forward to seeing who you've got on next time.
Chris, anything else to add?
No, I think we've come to the end.